Hello children, welcome to AIIMS India's online classes. This is biology session, reproduction in plants. So far we have completed asexual reproduction, vegetative reproduction, methods of vegetative reproduction, and even micropropagation, that is tissue culture. And in the methods of vegetative propagation, in the last class we have completed layering and grafting, okay, and some basic events of sexual reproduction. So in order to undergo the sexual reproduction, an organism should possess special organs, isn't it? So in plants, the organ specialized to perform sexual reproduction is flowers. Flowers are basically modified shoots. That's why they are also called reproductive shoots. A typical flower has 4 whorls of floral leaves. Okay, 4 main parts. What are they? Sepals, called as calyx, petals, called as corolla, stamens, male reproductive part, andrecium, it is also called, and carpels, it is also called gynoecium, the female reproductive part, or pistil, isn't it? Out of which are the main parts for the sexual reproduction? Stamens and carpels. Stamens and carpels are they are respectively represent the male and female reproductive organs of flowers. Okay, so and we discussed the formation of male gametes. Male reproductive organ, stamen. A stamen is the male reproductive unit of a flower. It consists of anther and filament. The anther is usually bilobed, with each lobe having 2 theca. That's why it is called dithecus. Okay, anther consisting of what? Some sac-like structures. What I called pollen sacs. Pollen sacs, or they are also called microsporangia. Microsporangia. These microsporangial walls has 4. Okay, they contain micro spore mother cells or pollen mother cells. Microspore mother cells are pollen mother cells, PMC. So they undergo 1 meiosis division and several mitotic divisions. That is called the formation of pollen grains, microsporogenesis. As the anther matures, okay, it produces the pollen grains, and the pollen grains are released off by breaking the walls of the anther. Okay, and we also discussed about the female reproductive organ, that is pistil. It is consisting of 3 main parts. What are they? Here it is clearly mentioned. What are the 3 main parts? If you take stamen and filament, these 2 parts. But whereas if you take the female reproductive part, stigma, style, and ovary. This is the ovary, where the ovules are present. Inside the ovules, egg cell is present, female reproductive cell. Shall we proceed, children? The events of sexual reproduction. All sexually reproducing organisms differ in the structure associated with sexual reproduction. So the events of sexual reproduction may be grouped into 3. What are they? Pre-fertilization, fertilization, and post-fertilization events. Okay, means before fertilization, what are the events takes place, and fertilization, after fertilization, called post-fertilization events. So pre-fertilization events are gametogenesis. and gamete transfer. The gametogenesis. Gametogenesis is the term which represent the process of formation of gametes. It refers to the process of formation of both male and female gametes, which are haploid in nature. So homogametes or isogametes means both the gametes are similar in appearance and cannot be categorized into male and female. Okay, what are homogametes or isogametes means? If both the gametes are similar in appearance, male and female, and cannot be categorized or differentiated into male and female, it is called homogametes or isogametes. Example, in cladophora, this kind of homogametes are produced. Heterogametes. Heterogametes means the two gametes are morphologically different and categorized into male gametes. They are also called antherozoites or sperms. And the female gametes, they are also called eggs. Okay, example, Funaria, Pteris, Cycas, Fucus. Okay, some of the gymnosperms. Okay, they show these heterogametes. So, formation of male gametes, anther. Just now we have discussed. In the anther of a flower, certain diploid cells present. They undergo meiosis, forming haploid spores. They are called microspores, little spores. These microspores divide by mitosis to form two-celled pollen consisting of a tube cell and a generative cell. This is a structure of male gamete. Okay. Next, a pollen grain. Actually, if the a pollen grain, if you take means this pollen or a male gamete, it is the first cell of a male gametophyte. The size of the nucleus increases and it divides mitotically to produce a bigger cell that is called vegetative cell or tube cell, and a smaller cell, it is called as a generative cell. Here the tube cell and a generative cell said no. So bigger one is the tube cell or vegetative cell, and the smaller one is the generative cell. The vegetative cell is bigger and has abundant food reserves and a large irregularly shaped nucleus. Okay, in the diagram we can see. Next, the generative cell is small and it is spindle shape with a dense cytoplasm and a nucleus. Okay, so if this is a pollen grain structure, if the pollen reach a receptive stigma, the female plant part or the female part of the flower, the pollen germinates and the generative cell, which is smaller in size, divides by mitosis to form two sperms. The tube cell elongates to form the pollen tube. This tube cell is very large in size, so it germinates to produce a pollen tube. Whereas the generative cell, consisting of the two nuclei, male nuclei, okay, it divides by mitosis and produce two male nuclei or sperms. Okay. See here. The pollen mother cell, PMC, which is in diploid. Diploid means two sets of chromosomes are present, 2N. By meiosis 1 and meiosis 2, means meiosis division is divided into two parts, meiosis 1 and meiosis 2. By the end of meiosis 2, 4 tetrad of 4 haploid microspores are produced. 4 haploid microspores. Okay. Then they separate from each other, separate pollen grains. They are the pollen grains. If you take one mature pollen grain, the structure, it consisting of actually two walls, exine and intine. Exine is the outer wall, which is thick, outer, sculptured wall, whereas intine, okay? So this intine is the inner wall. It is thin and elastic. It emerges out as the pollen grain form. It emerges out as the pollen tube from the germ pores during germination. During germination, this intine only develops into pollen tube like this. The gaps are present, no? So here, generative nucleus. Generative nucleus later forms two male nuclei, male gametes, whereas the tube nucleus, this tube nucleus develops into or tube cell, we can say, tube cell or tube nucleus. This tube nucleus only develops into pollen tube. Whereas generative nucleus present in the generative cell or generative nucleus, it breaks into two male gametes, two sperms. Okay, children? So it's very simple. In the anther, the pollen mother cells, PMC, they undergo meiosis and produce four pollen grains. Each pollen grain consisting of a generative nucleus or a generative cell and a tube cell. So this tube cell develop into the pollen tube after the during the germination of pollen grain when it reaches the stigma of the flower, and the generative nucleus, it breaks into two male gametes, two male nuclei. Okay, next, formation of female gametes. The female gametes or the eggs are formed in the ovules within the flower. Okay, the female reproductive organ, what is that? Pistil. A pistil has a terminal receptive disc like stigma is present, a stalk like style is present, and a basal swollen ovule bearing part which is called as a ovary. Inside the ovary, it is a ovarian cavity, okay, and a cushion like structure is present, that is called placenta. You will study in higher class. So to that placenta, these ovules are attached. Okay, an ovule is an integumented megasporangium. Microsporangium means male gametes are produced from that megasporangium. Here, see here, as above said, a certain diploid cell undergoes meiosis. However, in this case, the result is four haploid megaspores, large spores. They are small spores. Three of the megaspores, which are produced by meiosis, they die, and the remaining one will undergo mitosis division several times. One of these daughter cells then functions as the egg cell, which is ready to unite with the sperm cell. So here the concept is given directly. So if you go through the formation of embryo sac or the female gamete, it is called embryo sac. Actually, it consisting of set of 8 cells. Okay, so inside the ovary, ovules are present. Inside the ovule, the megaspore mother cell, which undergo the meiosis, okay, and produce four haploid megaspores, N. Okay, here 2N represents the diploid. Then out of these four, how many disappear? Three will disappear, degenerate megaspores, and only one will remain, surviving megaspore. So that surviving megaspore undergo the mitosis division, several mitotic divisions, and produce 8 nucleated embryo sac, clearly given in this picture. Try to understand. Okay, 8 nucleated embryo sac is produced. Out of these 8 nucleated, 3 are antipodals. Okay, one secondary nucleus are polar nuclei, which consisting of diploid 2 nuclei. Then 2 synergids and 1 egg cell. Only one egg cell is produced here. an ovule consisting of only one egg cell with the formation of embryo sac. Okay, it is very clear. The process of formation of megaspores from the megaspore mother cell is called megasporogenesis, whereas in the male, microsporogenesis we come across. Okay, the ovules generally differentiate a single megaspore mother cell, single megaspore mother cell, MMC. Okay, in the micropolar region of the nucleus, a single megaspore mother cell in the micropylar region. The megaspore mother cell undergoes meiosis to form four haploid megasporangium. Okay, four haploid megaspores. Here it is clearly mentioned. It undergoes meiosis and produces four megaspores which are haploid. Out of four megaspores in a linear tetrad, means straight tetrad, usually the upper three degenerate. Okay, it is mentioned reversely. Upper three will degenerate and the lowermost enlarges to form or to become functional megasporangium. It is a surviving megasporangium or surviving megaspore. Okay, surviving megaspore. So that surviving megaspore will undergo the mitosis and produce 8 celled cell, that is 8 nucleated cell, that is called as a embryo sac. A mature embryo sac consisting of 3 antipodals, 1 egg cell, 2 synergids and 1 secondary nucleus or polar nuclei. Okay, so next event, what is that? This is the post fertilization change. Now fertilization. What is fertilization? Before fertilization, one event occur, that is the pollination. So this is not mentioned here because you already studied in the regular textbook. What is pollination? The term pollination refers to the process of transfer of pollen grains from anther to the stigma, from anther of the stamen to the receptive stigma of the carpel of the same or genetically different flowers of the same species. Okay, it is called as a pollination. Simply you can remember, the process of transfer of pollen grains from anther to the stigma of the flower is called pollination. So it is of two types, self-pollination, cross-pollination. If it takes place in the same flower, it is self-pollination. If it takes place in the different flowers of the same species also, it is cross-pollination. Okay, so there are different types of pollinations which you have studied. What are they? Anemophily. Anemophily means the pollination by wind. Hydrophily, pollination by water. There are several agents which helps in the process of pollination, like air, water. Then any entomophily. Entomophily is the most important method of pollination in the most of the higher plants. Pollination by insects is called as entomophily. And ornithophily, in some plants pollination takes place by birds, it is called ornithophily. And if it takes place by bats, it is called chiropterophily. Chiropterophily, examples are also there. You have to remember, chiropterophily you can see in the Anthocerophallus. Okay, Adansonia, some examples. Okay, which shows very large in size the flowers are. So after pollination, the fertilization takes place. Post pollination events we can also call it as, that is fertilization. The pollen grains which fall on the stigma, they are held or stick by its sticky secretion and start germinating in the presence of moisture, and the nutrients available on the stigmatic disc. The nucleus of the pollen grain divides to produce vegetative and generative cells, a short cytoplasm outgrowth called germ tube, which emerges from the pollen and continues to grow as a pollen tube. Okay, so the generative cell and the vegetative cell, these are the two cells produced by the division of nucleus of the pollen grains. Okay, and the germ tube emerges out of the pollen grain and develops into a pollen tube. Through that pollen tube, the two nuclei, male nuclei or sperms, will enter into the ovule. Okay. During its growth, the pollen tube secretes an enzymes which digest the tissue of the stigma and style. Okay. So as soon as the pollen tube is growing in size, it secretes certain enzymes which digest the stigma and style. They will disappear by the end of fertilization. Okay, here the pollen grain, as soon as it reaches the sticky stigma, it germinates to produce the pollen tube. Okay, this pollen tube later digests the style and the stigma. Okay, the pollen tube grows lengthwise and opens into the ovule. This region through which the pollen tube enters the embryo sac is the micropyle. Micropyle is the opening of ovule. Okay, so here the male gametes, two male nuclei are there. So the nuclei will enter into this, and one of the male nuclei will combines with the egg cell. This egg cell is protected by synergids. The middle one is the egg cell, and another male nuclei will fuses with the secondary nucleus or polar nuclei. Okay, it will form endosperm, and the nucleus, after combining with the egg cell, it will form the zygote. The process of fusion of gametes is called fertilization. Further we will discuss. The pollen tube grows chemotropically and intracellularly into the style due to the concentration gradient of calcium boron inositol sugar complex. So this is the chemical which is produced by this pollen tube. Calcium boron inositol sugar complex. The nucleus of the generative cell forms two male gametes by mitotic division. The pollen tube eventually enters the ovule through its micropyle and embryo sac through one of the synergids. Later on, the two male gametes or sperms are discharged into the embryo sac. Okay, like this. Here in this picture, it is very clear, you see. This is the stigma, the pollen grain germinates to produce the pollen tube, and there are two male nuclei or the sperm cells. They are discharged into the embryo sac through one of the synergids. These are the synergids which are surrounding the egg cell. So here this is these two are synergids actually. This is the nucellus. This yellow color part is the nucellus, which is called the tissue which protect the embryo sac. Okay, this is the embryo sac. Embryo sac consisting of 8 nuclei. Okay, so out of which all are diploid except this egg cell, and the two polar nuclei are present in this secondary nucleus, or it is also called the female gametophyte, is also called the embryo sac. The egg is the female gamete. So these sperm cells, will enter into the embryo sac through micropylar region of the ovule. Now the fertilization. In angiosperms means the flowering plants, double fertilization is the most important event. A typical event, one of the male gametes fuses with the egg, resulting in the production of zygote. This is called syngamy. Okay, the first fertilization, it is called syngamy. One of the male gametes moves towards the egg cell and fuses with its nucleus, thus completing the syngamy. Syngamy results in the formation of a diploid cell called zygote. The second male gamete, the other male gamete, moves towards the two polar nuclei or secondary nucleus located in the central cell and fuses with them to produce a triploid primary endosperm nucleus, or we can also simply call it as PEN, primary endosperm nucleus. So this is called triple fusion. As this involves the fusion of three haploid nuclei, it is termed as a triple fusion. Okay, since two types of fusions takes place, one is syngamy and second one is triple fusion, in an embryo sac the phenomenon is termed as a double fertilization, and it is an unique feature of the flowering plants. The central cell after triple fusion becomes the primary endosperm cell. Okay, thus the embryo sac, there occurs two sexual fusions, one is the syngamy and the other is the triple fusion. This phenomenon is called double fertilization. See here, the double fertilization. So this is the embryo sac consisting of antipodals, polar nuclei, egg cell and synergids. So as the pollen tube germinates and releases the two male nuclei, one of the male nuclei fuses with the egg cell and another male nuclei fuses with the polar nuclei or secondary nucleus. Okay, this will form the endosperm nucleus. The nucleus which feeds, which combines with the two polar nuclei will form a triploid nucleus that is called endosperm. And the male nucleus which combines with the egg cell results in the diploid cell that is called as a zygote. Okay. So this is the unique feature, double fertilization and triple fusion. It is a unique feature of typical angiosperms. Okay. And this endosperm develops into endosperm cell and develops into endosperm, while the zygote develops into an embryo. Okay. So this is the process of fertilization. And next event, double fertilization and its significance. Just now we discussed about the double fertilization. The process of fertilization, which occurs two times. First fertilization between the egg cell and one of the male nucleus, which results in the formation of zygote. The second fertilization between the male nucleus and the two polar nuclei, which results in the formation of endosperm. This is double fertilization. What does the significance means? Double fertilization gives birth to the seed embryo, which is diploid, and to the endosperm, which is triploid. The endosperm supplies food materials to the developing embryo, due to which the embryo is differentiated properly, leading to the formation of a seed. It provides some characteristics of the male parent to the nutritive tissue embryo. This is the advantage of double fertilization. The endosperm supplies the food materials to the developing embryo. Okay. And it provides the characteristics of the male parent to the nutritive tissue endosperm. So here once again showing the double, the endosperm, which is the 3N nucleus, 2 polar nucleus combines with a sperm to form endosperm. Okay, the first sperm combines with the egg cell and form zygote. Okay, endosperm and embryo. The endosperm in angiosperms develops from the primary endosperm nucleus, which is formed as a result of triple fusion. It is a nutritive tissue that supplies food materials to the growing embryo and also the seedlings. Seedlings means baby plants. The primary endosperm nucleus is triploid, as it is formed by the fusion of one of the male gamete or male nuclei and the two polar nuclei. So it divides to form a large triploid endosperm. There are three types of endosperms based on the first and the subsequent divisions of the primary endosperm nucleus. There are three types: nuclear type, cellular type, and holotype, holobial type. So you will study in higher classes. These are the three types of endosperms. An endosperm development proceeds. Okay, it precedes the development. The formation of endosperm is initiated by mitotic divisions of the primary endosperm nucleus, which is 3N. And if the endosperm is present, albuminous seeds. If endosperm is absent, exalbuminous seeds. Okay, non-endospermic seeds and endospermic seeds are there. Endosperm may be completely consumed by the developing embryo before seed formation, then it becomes non-endospermic seeds. They are called exalbuminous seeds. Example, pea. In some mature seeds, endosperm will be retained, that is castor, cereals. Okay. So it is antipodals, mature embryo sac here. There are synergids, apparatus through which the pollen tube enters inside and fuses with the egg cell. The antipodals just they degenerate. Next, post fertilization changes. What are the changes occur after fertilization, or we can say formation of fruit and seed? In angiosperms, the seed is the final product of sexual reproduction. It is often described as a fertilized ovule. The seeds are formed inside the fruit. Fruit is a mature, ripened ovary which develops after fertilization. If the fruit develops without fertilization, then it is called a parthenocarpic fruit. A parthenocarpic fruit is the fruit without seeds. Seedless fruits we will say, no, that is parthenocarpic fruit. So the seeds formed inside the fruits, typically a seed consisting of a seed coat and cotyledons and an embryonal axis. So a fruit usually consists of a wall and seeds. The wall of the fruit is called pericarp. Outer wall is called as a pericarp. And the pericarp can be dry or fleshy. A fleshy pericarp is differentiated into three layers, that is epicarp, mesocarp, endocarp. Okay, fruit is covered by means of a layer called pericarp. That pericarp may be dry or fleshy. If it is fleshy, it is again divided into three parts. What are they? Epicarp, endocarp, and mesocarp. Now come to seed. The ovules develop into seeds after fertilization. A seed is composed of a seed coat and an embryo. The embryo is composed of a radical and an embryonal axis and one or two cotyledons. Okay? So if you take the fruits, there are some fruits are categorized into true fruit and false fruit. Just basic I am giving you. The fruit derived from ovary of a flower, not associated with any non-carpellary part, it is called a true fruit. For example, tomato, grapes, cucumber, pea, these are all true fruits. The fruit, false fruit means the fruit derived from the ovary along with other accessory floral parts, it is called a false fruit. Example, strawberry and apple. Okay, so this parthenocarpy, polyembryony and apomixis, these are some of the methods. Parthenocarpy means formation of fruit without fertilization is called parthenocarpy. Parthenocarpic fruits are seedless fruits. Then polyembryony means the phenomenon of having more than one embryo in a seed is called polyembryony. For example, you can see in the seeds like citrus, in the onion, groundnut, polyembryony is observed due to the fertilization of more than one egg. It is called simple polyembryony, or sometimes formation of extra embryos through sporophytic budding. It is called adventive polyembryony. Okay, apomixis is also the phenomenon. It is the formation of new individuals through asexual reproduction without involving the formation and fusion of gametes. It is called apomixis. Okay, children. So up to what is fertilization, what is pollination, what are the types of pollinations, and what are the post-fertilization changes? Here simply you can remember, after fertilization, the ovary develops into fruit, ovules develop into seeds. Okay? The integuments of the ovule develop into seed coats. Okay? I hope you understood, children. Please read the textbook. Thank you for watching our video. Please subscribe our channel and press the bell icon for receiving latest updates.